31, Mr. Lee secured the seat of Tanjung Pagar, a seat he held for 14 successive general elections and one by-election. His parliamentary career spanned nearly 60 years, earning him the honour of being the longest-serving Member of Parliament in Singapore and undoubtedly the most illustrious of them all. Mr. Lee became the first Prime Minister of Singapore after the People's Action Party secured 43 of the 51 seats in the Legislative Assembly during the general election of 1959. He took the reins of leadership for 31 years and led the then fledgling Singapore through a most uncertain time. He gave the founding generation hope and a clear sense of direction, especially when Singapore was taking its first tentative steps as an independent nation. This was just what our forefathers needed. Mr. Lee was a conviction politician. When asked in his memoirs what it took to be a politician, he said, "You must have convictions." Mr. Lee himself did not set out with the aspiration to be a politician. In his memoirs, he recounted that he returned to Singapore from his overseas studies to be a lawyer. But he was driven to assume public office by two convictions. One, he wanted a Singapore without a colonial master. And two, he wanted a system that focused on meritocracy. In Parliament, Mr. Lee set very high standards for himself and expected the same from all the other members of Parliament too. In a speech to Parliament in 1999, Mr. Lee said that he wanted members of Parliament whose instincts are immediately for Singaporeans. He reminded us that Parliament, as an arena for the contest of wits and wills over matters of policies, will always remain important because of our system of parliamentary democracy. But that we must make no mistake. In this chamber, we are playing for keeps. The future of Singapore and its people is not a question for light-hearted banter. Even when he was ill and quite frail, Mr. Lee would make tremendous effort to attend Parliament sittings as he took his duties very seriously. Mr. Lee never flinched from taking hard decisions, many of which were taken in this august chamber. In 1968, when speaking on the employment bill, he said, "We will be judged as a government by results. These results depend, among other things, upon the morale and enthusiasm of the people and the pace set by their leaders in Parliament and outside." Mr. Lee's abiding concern was the interest and welfare of the people, even if there were painful adjustments to be made in the short term. People respected and followed him because of one very important element, and that is trust. They trusted that he did not make decisions for his own self-aggrandizement or personal benefit, but truly for the benefit of Singapore. Mr. Lee's personal leadership and his style and values helped shape the tone and the kind of parliament that we have inherited today. Deeply committed to Singapore, passionate to ensure not just Singapore's survival, but also its success, he was a leader par excellence. He had devoted his entire life to make the life of all Singaporeans better. Mr. Lee has left a deep impact on this house, and we will feel the vacuum. The least that we as parliamentarians can do now is to uphold the values that he held dear when he was alive. In 1999, when we moved to this chamber from the old Parliament House, Mr. Lee said, "The importance of this chamber did not and does not depend on its size and its grandeur, but upon the quality of men and women who occupy it as representatives of the people. By the standards of other public and private buildings in Singapore, it is modest by comparison, but that is a virtue. Behind the understatement lie great strength of character, integrity, and determination. That is what will see Singapore through," he said. "Not the grand statements and monuments in brick and mortar or steel and concrete, with which so many other new nations try to impress themselves and their followers, he said. Mr. Lee could very well have described himself and his own life when he made that statement. Mr. Lee reminded us that nobody believed that we could make it, but we have. But there is no reason to believe, he said, that we will continue to make it. We will continue to make it only if there are tough-minded people who know the difference between the froth and the substance. Honourable members, it now falls upon us as members of this House to ensure that we continue Mr. Lee's legacy of a responsible and effective Parliament, a duty we owe to the people of Singapore. The House records with deep regret the passing of the Honourable Member of Parliament for Tanjung Pagar GRC and founding Prime Minister of the Republic of Singapore, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. On behalf of all members, I wish to express our deepest sympathy and condolences to the family of the late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. I also wish to thank the thousands that have braved the hot sun to pay their last respects to Mr. Lee for your support and your sympathies. In this moment of grief, we have become even more united as Singaporeans. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's death is indeed a grievous loss to Singapore and this House. Leader of the House, Mr. Ng Eng Hin.
Madam Speaker, today this House mourns the passing of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, the founding Prime Minister of Singapore. As you have said, Madam Speaker, Mr. Lee was our longest serving and most illustrious member. When Mr. Lee was admitted to SGH a few weeks ago for pneumonia, Singaporeans from all walks of life watched anxiously, increasingly worried as his condition worsened. There were well wishes, little cards placed all over SGH, so much so that SGH had to create a special site in their quad. We saw elderly Singaporeans with arthritic joints, kneeling, prostrated themselves for his recovery. Despite the outpouring of deep wishes and fervent prayers, it was not to be. Mr. Lee's chair sits empty today. His loss is deeply felt. A nation cries out in mourning. No one moved Singapore as Mr. Lee Kuan Yew did. Not in life, not in sickness, and not in death. We in this House, together with all Singaporeans here and abroad, weep that Mr. Lee is no longer among us. Why this deep sorrow for one man? Why do tears flow uncontrollably for thousands on his passing and memory? Simply put, Singapore would not be what it is today without Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. He was that bright night star that guided us, an impoverished and fearful nation, through independence. He envisioned, then drove Singapore to become a success story, as he promised, from mud flats to a thriving metropolis that countries all over seek to emulate. Today, Singaporeans hold their passports with confidence and pride. Mr. Lee's vision and tenacity rallied and energized the nation to overcome seemingly insurmountable odds. He coaxed, pushed Singaporeans to do what was difficult, but ultimately right and good for their long-term interests. With his powers of persuasion, Mr. Lee's clarity and confidence became ours, the people's, the mark of a great leader. Mr. Lee is no longer with us. But I believe, as many do here, that each generation will discover anew his wisdom in building the sturdy foundations of a thriving Singapore. His life is like a treasure chest. Each visit through his many deeds and words, and you see it now in the community tribute sites, the videos that played, the people who sit there riveted by what he said, how he said it, his convictions, the courage of his convictions, his clarity, what he believed in, what he saw as problems. And as you replay it, you reveal pearls of wisdom, nuggets of sound advice, as I found for this eulogy. For such a monumental life, any eulogy will fall short, and I seek your pardon. But to honor his memory and remind us what he stood for, I propose to capture the essence of Mr. Lee through his speeches, the very words he used in this parliament. Even at the dawn of his political career, Mr. Lee identified closely with the hopes and aspirations of common Singaporeans. Madam Speaker, you mentioned his first election in 1955. There he told the voters of Tanjung Pagar that out of 25 divisions, he wanted to, quote, represent workers, wage earners, and small traders, not wealthy merchants or landlords. That is why he chose Tanjung Pagar, not Tanglin. The residents of Tanjung Pagar believed and trusted him and elected him by a handsome margin. Astonishingly, as the Madam Speaker has said, Mr. Lee would be returned as the MP for 13 subsequent general elections. He would serve as MP for Tanjung Pagar for 60 years, from 1955 to 2015. In fact, he's the only MP that Tanjung Pagar has ever had since elections were started in Singapore, predating our independence. I doubt this record will ever be broken in our parliamentary history. But Mr. Lee and his government did not get re-elected time and time again because they dispensed sweet words. Indeed, Mr. Lee would often warn against politicians with silver tongues, purveying sweet promises, empty promises. He gained a fearsome reputation as one who eschewed the easier, more popular, but ultimately wrong paths, as he recounted in his book, Hard Truths. Flattery fell flat on him, as did lofty but pretentious ideals. For Mr. Lee, the acid test was whether the idea or proposal would make Singapore stronger. If it weakened this country's foundations, he would reject it. Even if it was politically incorrect to say so and attracted widespread criticism. If it would make Singapore better, then no obstacles, no preconceived notions, no preset habits were too deeply entrenched to uproot or overcome. Indeed, he will attack these hindrances squarely and vigorously to improve our circumstances. That was the Lee Kuan Yew the world knew and respected throughout his political life. In 1968, an MP asked this in Parliament how the British withdrawal could impact Singapore. Mr. Lee told Singaporeans matter-of-factly that the British bases made up 20% of the GNP and tens of thousands of jobs would be lost. He spoke plainly. There was more to come. He told Singaporeans, quote, that they would have to adapt and adjust without any whimpering or wringing of hands as a way of life which they have been accustomed to over 30 years comes to an end. A truly hard truth. When another MP followed and asked if economic aid from the British could ease the effects of the pullout, Mr. Lee's quick and unequivocal rejoinder was that any aid should, quote, not make us dependent on perpetual injections of aid from the outside, that we cannot change our attitude to life, that the world does not owe us a living, this was the origin of the phrase, that the world does not owe us a living, and that we cannot live by the begging bowl. The best way of meeting the problem is to go about it quietly and intelligently, discussing our problems in a low key and with as little fuss and bother as possible. Unquote. These were his words in 1971 when the British were pulling out. There was steel in the tone of these replies. But Mr. Lee revealed later in 1999 that he knew how serious the problem really was. He said, 1968 to 1971 were critical years for our young republic. We knew we either made it or we would fail. We worked hard, we worked smart, and more important, we worked as a team. By the time the British withdrew in October 1971, we had avoided massive unemployment. Mr. Lee said, with as little fuss as possible. But in those critical years, it would mean a fundamental overhaul of what Singaporeans had indeed become accustomed to but could not afford. To stop the rot, Mr. Lee rooted out corruption, attacked the malaise that afflicted our society and economy. What followed would remake the work environment, industrial relations, schools, skills upgrading, productivity, defense and security. The very issues we talk about in Parliament today, but in a much more parlous state. He rid Singapore of unsavory, unproductive and unsustainable habits and customs inherited from its past. A slew of legislative reforms followed in this House. Amendments were made to the Employment Industrial Relations, the Trade Unions Act, that put an end to disruptive labor strikes. Bills were passed to build technical training institutes, the forerunners of today's ITE, polytechnics and universities, to educate and upgrade the skills of our workforce. Work hours were extended and the number of public holidays slashed. As you can imagine, none of these bills was popular, not one. All of us in government and as MPs on the ground know how difficult it is to carry unpopular policies, even when they are right. Why did Mr. Lee and his government choose to persuade Singaporeans to do again and again what was necessary but painful? Mr. Lee himself provided us the answer. He said in 1968 in this House, quote, "If we were a soft community, then the temptation would be to leave things alone and hope for the best. Then only good fortune can save us from the unpleasantness, which reason and logic tell us is ahead of us. But we are not an easygoing people. We cannot help thinking, calculating, and planning for tomorrow, for next week, for the next month, for the next year, for the next generation. And it is because we have restless minds, forever probing and testing, seeking new and better solutions to old and new problems, that we have never been, and I trust never shall be, tried and found wanting." Unquote. Mr. Lee spoke these words in 1968 to remind Singaporeans that unless they were willing to change and continuously adapt, even if it meant short-term gain, Singapore could not rise. In return for the people's trust and willingness to do what was needed, Mr. Lee and his government promised a better Singapore after these reforms. To quote, "more industries, more jobs, improved standards of education, health services, social amenities, and housing for all." Again, the issues we talk about in our parliaments today. But as prescient as these words were, it seemed an unattainable dream when Mr. Lee gave these promises in 1968. Singapore's per capita GDP then was around Myanmar today. It would take a further two decades of constant effort and continuous change, seeking new and better solutions, as he put it, which included CPF reforms and the introduction of national service in 1967. But at the end of it, Mr. Lee and his government delivered. Cabinet colleagues remember Mr. Lee, our mentor, often reminding us to under-promise and over-deliver. Say less and do more. What you promise, you must deliver and more. Mr. Lee walked his talk. Even in his twilight years, Mr. Lee kept a constant watch over Singapore's future in the world. Singapore's well-being was his obsession, as many of us know. Woe betide anyone who tried to knock it down. He was never complacent about our fundamentals, and his singular passion was to make sure that Singapore remained well-positioned for the future. In 2009, Mr. Lee, then at 86 years, unexpectedly joined a debate on a motion about equality in this House. He said, quote, "Sir, I had not intended to intervene in any debate, but I was doing my physiotherapy just now and reading the newspapers, and I thought I should bring the House back to earth and remind everybody what is our starting point, what is our base, and if we do not recognize where we started from and that these are our foundations, we will fail." 86-year-old gentleman doing his physiotherapy, reading the newspapers. Lesser mortals would have thought of other things, but Mr. Lee says, "I have to make a speech in Parliament." Mr. Lee went on to explain why the Constitution of Singapore enjoins us, the government, to specifically look after the position of the Malays and other minorities. Our Constitution states expressly that it is the duty of the government not to treat everybody as equal. Quote, as he said, it is not a reality, it is not practical, it will lead to grave and irreparable damage if we work on that principle. Lee Kuan Yew refused to be swayed by ideology that could not work. He considered these as, quote, highfalutin ideals that misled Singaporeans. As a result, today, many countries come to Singapore to study how we have maintained our harmony in a multiracial society. But while Mr. Lee held constant and firm to key fundamentals, he could change his own mind if it made Singapore better. In 2005, he supported a proposal to build integrated resorts. He told this house why. Quote, the old model on which I worked was to create a first world city in a third world region, clean, green, efficient, pleasant, healthy, and wholesome, safe and secure for everyone. These virtues are valuable, but no longer sufficient. Singapore has to reposition itself in this world. If you are in charge, if you are responsible for Singapore's future, for its well-being, for its vibrancy, for the kind of life Singapore can provide its people in 10, 20 years, can you say no? That is the question you have to answer. This is your choice. Surely we must move forward and keep abreast of the top cities in Asia and the world. Unquote. Above all, Mr. Lee believed that ultimately it was the quality of its people and leaders that determined a nation's chances of success. Madam Speaker has quoted what he said when Parliament moved in 1999. Mr. Lee never believed in the size of this chamber and its grandeur. He believed that the understatement lies great strengths of character, integrity, and determination. And that is what will see us through. Mr. Lee never believed that physical monuments or towering edifices engendered or sustained greatness. He would brush aside these as foundations for our success. This past week, we have seen the glowing tributes to Mr. Lee from leaders and on the front pages of newspapers from all over the world. Ministers and MPs from Australia and New Zealand have held special sessions in their parliaments in Mr. Lee's honor. World leaders are disrupting their schedules to come personally to attend his funeral service. This recognition is seldom given to even leaders of great countries, let alone a little red dot. I find it befitting and poetic that for one who did not believe in monuments, that Mr. Lee Kuan Yew himself became Singapore's greatest icon. Indeed, Mr. Lee has had such a monumental impact on all Singaporeans that each would have his or her own special memory of him. I'm sure all of us have one particular memory or particular memories with Mr. Lee. You read the tributes, the artworks, the banners, the beautifully crafted posters that tens of thousands of Singaporeans have laid at the tribute sites. Many others will certainly remember him as an internationally renowned great teacher and statesman. For myself, two personal encounters have left lasting impressions. In 2009, Mr. Lee led a delegation on an official trip to many states of Malaysia. Deputy Prime Minister Tharman and I were part of it. The delegation was having dinner together. It was a long trip. When Mr. Lee asked to excuse himself so that he could speak on the phone to Mrs. Lee. Due to previous strokes, Mrs. Lee could not speak, but remained conscious and aware. Mr. Lee had made it a routine to speak and read to her each night. He did not want to break this routine, even though he was in Malaysia on a long trip. He asked the nurse to put the phone to Mrs. Lee and spoke to her. He did this every night while we were in Malaysia. We stood aside to respect their privacy. But that image of Mr. Lee hunched over the phone speaking to Mrs. Lee, who could not speak back, will stay with me for a very long time. as a simple but pure picture of true devotion. Mrs. Lee passed away in 2010, and the impact on him was visible physically. I think many people noticed this. Mr. Lee indeed had become frail as he approached his 90th birthday in 2013. He had problems in swallowing, food would go down the wrong way into his windpipe, infecting his lungs repeatedly. As eating could cause aspiration pneumonia, he needed intravenous nutrition as supplement, but became progressively thinner. Parliament was sitting that year on September 16, his birthday, and we wanted to acknowledge his 90th birthday, an auspicious birthday. I called on Mr. Lee at the Istana and told him about our plans. He said he would be in Parliament that day on September 16. Unfortunately, when the day came, a dehydrated and weakened Mr. Lee had to go to hospital and be put on drip. His doctors advised him not to attend Parliament. We were informed, so we called off our plans. But just before Parliament adjourned, we were surprised when Mr. Lee entered the chamber. I found out later that he had overruled his doctors, saying that he must attend Parliament because he had given his commitment. He wanted to walk, actually, but thankfully, his doctors persuaded him that it would be acceptable for a 90-year-old man on intravenous nutrition to be wheeled into the chamber. That September 16, this House had the last privilege to wish him happy birthday together. After Parliament adjourned, he stayed on as we cut his birthday cake, sang him a birthday song. At age 90, frail and dehydrated, Mr. Lee kept his word to be here. Great strength of character, determination, and integrity. Lee Kuan Yew had all of these qualities and more. He kept his promises, what he said he would do, he would and more, whether it was for individuals or an entire nation. As we honor his memory, we resolve to learn from his example to be men and women, individually and collectively as a nation, to have that great strength of character, integrity, and determination. These values, as Mr. Lee emphasized, would see us through difficult times. We must maintain, as he put it, restless minds, forever probing and testing, seeking new and better solutions to old and new problems, so that we have never been, and I trust never shall be, tried and found wanting. We must aspire to these qualities that Mr. Lee asked of us, because that would be the greatest tribute to the memory of Lee Kuan Yew, of what he stood for, fought against, and desired for the good of Singapore and Singaporeans. There will not be another Lee Kuan Yew who made us better than we are or could be. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew founded, moved, and lifted a nation because of his unwavering devotion and a life poured out for Singapore. He has made all our lives better for many generations to come. Few mortals have accomplished so much in their lifetime. We in this house are honored to have lived and served with him. His legacy will live on through us and through this nation. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew had his critics while alive. He was asked on a number of occasions how he thought history would judge him, all at the end. His reply would invariably be non-committal. Once he replied factually, "I'd be dead by then." That was Mr. Lee. But today we have the opportunity to tell Mr. Lee, if he could hear us, and I believe he can. Mr. Lee, we would like to tell you that Singaporeans have decided. Thousands upon thousands have lined the streets on your journey from Sri Temasek to this Parliament House. They queued for hours under the hot sun to pay their respects here. They did so spontaneously, an outpouring of gratitude and admiration for what you have done for their lives. I believe thousands more will do so when you move from here to your final resting place on Sunday. Singaporeans shouted your name repeatedly and clapped with adulation. Mr. Lee, I'm sorry that they had to wait so long. I can just hear his reprimand in my ear. My cabinet colleagues walked through the crowds thanking our people for their patience. Singaporeans smiled, replied that the wait was little compared to what you had done for them. Employers let off workers who skipped meals to pay respects. Volunteers distributed food and drink to people in line. Parents brought their little children along, determined that their children should know who had been responsible for our good lives here. Senior citizens hobbled on walking sticks or on wheelchairs to say goodbye and thank you personally, despite their physical infirmities. Mr. Lee, all these Singaporeans, young and old, whose lives you have touched, it is they who matter, as you've always said, and who have pronounced the final judgment on your life's work. It is a great work that has surpassed all expectations. It is called Singapore, and filled with Singaporeans who love and revere you. Majulah Singapura, rest in peace.
Mr. Seng Han Tong.
Huayu Fayan. Today in Parliament, with a heart of gratitude and thanks, we remember a great man who served Singapore the whole life, our founding father, Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew. If we have to use four words to describe what he did, and that is a concern for the country, concern for the people. The last time Ms. Lee was in Parliament was the 5th of November last year. At that time, he was not mobile, but each of his steps, each of his turn of his body attracted our attention. We still remember on the 16th of September in 2013, we were all here to celebrate his 90th birthday. The National Archives on that occasion published a series of books, Singapore Chose Lee Kuan Yew. I then, at that time, visited him in his office and asked him, what was he most concerned about Singapore? He said, he need not worry about Singapore. Singapore has a group of younger and capable leaders to look after it. So he believed that Singapore will continue to do well. Singapore will continue to prosper and thrive. We can say that he left with heart of ease. Remember when he's celebrating his 88th birthday, we gave him a birthday card. This is a card, and I wished him alive to 100. He smiled and said, 90, no problem, I think, but 100, very difficult. So that's him, someone who is practical and based his statement on facts. His father had passed away at 94, her mother had passed away at age 69, so he said he would, if he passed away after age 80, then he would be happy with his life and fate. Because a person who is happy with life and fate would have heart of ease. And up to last year, when he was 90, remember, we also gave him a birthday card. So this is a photo taken on that day. And unfortunately, this year, he cannot celebrate SG50 with us. From the 1970s, I worked in the newspapers and became an MP in the 90s. Later on, I joined NTUC, altogether over 30 years. Because of work all these years, I had the opportunity to work with Ms. Lee, interact with him, and went overseas with him. From this contact at short distance, I have three conclusions. First, the founding father, Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, all his considerations are for the interests of Singapore. Second, politics is a long-term task. We must be down to earth and not be populist. Third, we must help the less advantaged or the disadvantaged so that everyone will have a better life. In the 80s, I was working in the news desk in the Zhao Bao, and I often accompanied him overseas, including US, Europe, China, India, Pakistan, Australia, New Zealand, and ASEAN. Whether it was President Reagan, Deng Xiaoping, whether it was Mrs. Gandhi or Suharto, in their eyes, Lee Kuan Yew was a good friend, and they knew the purpose of Mr. Lee's visit was to seek more multilateral interests or bilateral interests, but all for Singapore's interests. They recognized and appreciated Lee Kuan Yew and never considered us as a small country. Countries large and small, Singapore knew that Lee Kuan Yew received protocol and courtesy from all, and that showed that as long as we are strong and self-reliant, a small country has strong foreign relations. And during this period, he often invited us to have lunch or dinner with him. But whether it's lunch or dinner, it's always a working meal. Through the interactions, Mr. Lee shared with us his political wisdom, and we reflected some political issues, our views on the political issues. Sometimes he asked each of us to give him a report on a specific issue so that he can convey them to the ministry. In 2003, when SARS broke out, he knew that I was associated with the Taxis Association. He was the first one to send me an email. He wanted to know what the association was doing to help the taxi drivers. And he said if we needed his help, he would try his best to help. He said, I can help you to send a message to all the taxi drivers. So with a message signed by him, we pass on this message to all the taxi drivers. What are the things that they must pay attention to? All of us know that Mr. Lee was most concerned about the employer-employee relations in SIA. Whenever employees had different views, he met both of them. Protecting the competitive advantage of SIA was protecting the interests of Singapore. So we can say that he was very concerned about workers' welfare. He often met the union leaders, and he saw a greater purpose. It is to bring better jobs for Singapore workers, better lives for Singaporeans. The Industrial Relations Bill and the Employment Bill in 1968, he was the main driver behind them. Mr. Lee has gone. What kind of Singapore will be without Lee Kuan Yew? We can say that what Mr. Lee, founding Prime Minister, left behind is not the thoughts of Lee Kuan Yew. It is a system which includes governance by elitists, racial harmony, economic development, strong foreign relations, bilingual education, honesty and integrity, garden city, metropolis, and a heart of gratitude and home ownership. So this is like our smartphones. We can always upgrade and get better and apply more applications. When he was a young student in Cambridge, he decided to return to Singapore to join politics. He chose to join politics. At that time, Singapore had many choices. Singapore chose Lee Kuan Yew, and that is why we have the Singapore today. This morning, Madam Speaker, a few ministers and many MPs were at the lobby, staying the vigil in the lobby. We saw an endless stream of Singaporeans. After queuing up for hours, some of them in uniform, some of them in their working attire, some of them were not able to walk very well, but they all wanted to say goodbye to the founding Prime Minister. They could not help but cry. So here we saw the Singapore spirit. We can feel comforted and tell Mr. Lee that in future, when crisis appears again, we must be united together. We must seek consensus. So many of our comrades went to Istana after he passed away. We saw Diana's face show an air of pride. So we said, Mr. Lee, you are right to be proud. We are proud of you. So you have left, but we'll use the Singapore spirit to be united, to be together. And if Mr. Lee knows that we can continue to develop, he will be satisfied. We will always remember you, founding Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew.
Yeah, Kiang. The founding Prime Minister was an extraordinary political leader born out of that turbulent and uncertain era. Singapore at that time was a small island and an unnoticeable city. Economically, it relied on entrepreneurial trade. Militarily, it relied on the protection from the British troops. When Singapore was forced to leave Malaysia, I don't think many would have believed that Singapore could survive on its own. Not to mention to have imagined our achievements today. We all know that during that period, the country was to be rebuilt from scratch and there was high unemployment rate. Our neighbors were not particularly friendly either. To survive, we must have a global vision, attract foreign investment, and become part of the international market. However, this could put Singapore in the danger of becoming a big country's vassal and a pawn in the international political arena, which can be sacrificed at any time. These internal and external challenges were a grave test for Mr. Lee. With outstanding wisdom and courage, he traversed amongst the big countries and promoted Singapore's values to them and the potential benefit that Singapore can provide. He had won the respect of the leaders of these major powers. Without his efforts, our economy could not have been successful and Singapore could not have achieved its status and a living space today. For a small country to survive, besides a strong military defense, the political space is the key to maintain national interest and its survival. In Singapore, fighting for independence and the continuous political struggle awakened Singaporeans' political awareness. In the process of political movements and fighting together, consensus was forged between the people and Mr. Lee, as well as a common direction and mutual trust. This is the main reason why Singapore can leap from the third world to the first world within one generation. The success arose not just from Mr. Lee's extraordinary fighting spirit and tenacity, but also from his sincerity. However, I don't think that the PAP one-party rule is the key to Singapore's fast economic development, strong social cohesion, and unitedness. This is because many Singaporeans were sacrificed during the process of nation building and policy making, and our society has paid the price for it. This is why Mr. Lee is also a controversial figure in some people's eyes. He crafted policies based on the situation then and made rational judgment out of the interest of the country. However, the choice and implementation of policies is not just a rational decision. It should also take into consideration human nature and sensitivity. Only by doing so can we avoid hurting people's feelings and creating resentment. If accumulated over a long time, the resentment could become a potential political crisis and affect people's unity and their identification with the country.
From my dealings with Mr. Lee in Parliament, I don't think he was an autocrat who didn't listen. If you have strong reasons and tight argument and can win him over in the thought-through policy debate, I think he will consider your views. I also know he was someone who hated empty talking because he thought time was precious and there were too many things to do. Singapore is a multiracial society, and every race has its own language and culture. In the early years of nation building, everyone hoped to maintain their advantages in this new country. How to manage the various conflicts of interests, unite people, and build a national identity was a tremendous challenge. Countries with similar situations as we were in the early days are still facing the same social conflicts brought about by multiracialism and multiculturalism. Some even face the danger of disintegration. Singapore today is united regardless of race, language, and religion. This is an achievement that is not possible without Mr. Lee. My deepest respect goes to founding Prime Minister Mr. Lee Kuan Yew.
Wong Kan Sing.
Madam Speaker, this is one of the saddest days in my life. I first met Mr. Lee Kuan Yew at his Istana when I was a young officer to attend a meeting with Dr. Lee Goh Keng Swee at his Istana in 1973. In 1984, I had the daunting experience of sitting before him to be interviewed by the SecGen Committee to join politics. Since 1985, I had the privilege of working with him as my Prime Minister, mentor, and colleague. Throughout his six decades of public service, the late Mr. Lee had only one mission, and that was to create a better life for all Singaporeans. In one generation, Singapore was transformed. The results of Mr. Lee's lifelong dedication are all over Singapore. No words can truly describe or reflect his contribution and the great impact he made on the lives of millions of Singaporeans, including mine. His policies enabled me, son of hawker parents, to become a deputy prime minister. Many poor families' children have done well too. Many in this house came from humble beginnings. Social mobility is not an abstract theory in Singapore. Good leadership and governance have been crucial to Singapore's success. For Singapore to overcome adversity had not been easy. Nations with far more than we had at the point of our independence have fallen short. Many nations, large and small, have studied the Singapore story. Singaporeans benefit from this sterling reputation when they travel, live, and work overseas. In the last few days, many Singaporeans I met told me how lucky they are and how proud they are to carry the red passport when they traveled. My foreign friends said they wish they had a Lee Kuan Yew. Indeed, we are blessed to have had him as our leader. Mr. Lee and his team took bold, tough decisions in the interests of the country and not for themselves. The pioneer generation of Singaporeans understood the existential crisis they faced. They worked hard and trusted Mr. Lee and his colleagues to bring them a better life. They were willing to make short-term sacrifices for long-term good. As a result, the leadership team was able to create an economic, social, and political ecosystem that has made Singapore unique, successful, and relevant to the world. Mr. Lee imbued the In Singapore, the values and principles of meritocracy, multiracialism, non-corruptibility, and belief in the rule of law, and built the institutions to ensure that these core values and principles are practiced. When many colonies' leaders of his time had hung on to power long after gaining independence, Mr. Lee was a firm believer and practitioner in self-renewal of leadership. He did not hold power for himself. He did it for Singapore. He played a personal role in recruiting and developing the younger team of ministers. I remember nostalgically the lunches he had with me as a new minister in the 1980s, together with one or two of my colleagues. We could ask any question and he would share his thoughts and experience. I also learned a lot during the many dinners at the Pisana poolside hosted by Mr. Lee for foreign leaders. These were occasions when great minds converged to discuss issues of the world. Mr. Lee brought the younger ministers on his overseas trips to give them exposure to international relations. These trips offered practical lessons in diplomacy. When he was Prime Minister, I had the privilege of joining his trips across Asia, Europe, and the United States. My first overseas visit with Mr. Lee was to Jakarta in May 1985, when it was hosted by the late President Suharto. In September 1985, he was hosted by the late Deng Xiaoping in Beijing. Both rolled out the red carpet for him. I experienced up close how Mr. Lee interacted with foreign leaders of countries much larger and more powerful than Singapore. They showed great respect and admiration for Mr. Lee and his achievements for Singapore. They treated him as an equal and listened keenly to his analysis of world issues. They valued his insights. These meetings were an eye-opener for me. It made me feel very proud to be a Singaporean and to be able to serve under him. Even before he stepped down as Prime Minister in 1990, Mr. Lee would encourage the younger ministers to make decisions because he felt that we would have to implement them and be accountable to the people. When issues of critical importance were discussed at cabinet meetings, Mr. Lee would express his views and explain his thinking, sometimes vigorously and forcefully. But at the end of the discussion, he would say, "You, the younger team, are in charge, and it is your decision to make. I have given my views." Some people think that Mr. Lee broke no dissent and was autocratic. That was wrong. That is wrong. For Mr. Lee has strong views, he also listened. When convinced, he would change his views. Beneath the public persona of Mr. Lee is a tough-minded man who suffered no fools. Mr. Lee had only the interests of Singaporeans at heart. That is why he spent his whole adult life caring for Singaporeans' welfare, uplifting our well-being, and protecting Singapore's interests. We are the beneficiaries of his lifelong dedication and contribution to Singapore. At a personal level, Mr. Lee was a caring man. Some years ago, a doctor diagnosed me to have transient ischemic attack, or TIA. Mr. Lee learned about it and called me up on the phone. On hearing that I was attending a dinner, he nagged me to go home, as he believed that my heart was like a ticking time bomb. I might suffer a stroke if I did not go back to rest. He insisted that I seek a psychologist's advice, which he also named the doctor, and I saw the doctor the following day. Dr. Lee Willing also recommended a neurologist friend to see me. And on the neurologist's recommendation, I saw another neurologist, and it turned out that I had no TIA. I was relieved, and I believe he was very relieved too. Madam Speaker, here I would like to say a few words in Mandarin.
Mr. Lee Kuan Yew is a great man across centuries. He often reminded us that some policies were like bitter medicines, which might be hard to stomach in the short term. But as long as the purpose of the policies is to benefit the people, then we must persist. History will judge Mr. Lee's achievements. In my heart, I feel that Mr. Lee had devoted all his life for Singapore and was a responsible, good Prime Minister. In the future, there will not be another great leader like him. Cultivate oneself, manage the family, govern the country, and attain world peace. Mr. Lee have achieved them all. He had devoted all his life to Singapore and left us a prosperous and harmonious home. He's on issue.
His health declined in recent years, but he was still mentally sharp. It pained me each time I saw him appearing in public, attending to the call of duty. I would have preferred to remember him when he was much fitter physically and not so gaunt and frail. Today, we enjoy an international reputation as a clean, green, efficient country with low level of corruption and a strong government supported by the electorate for more than 50 years. Our children and the grandchildren are fortunate to grow up in prosperity and stability. They did not experience the difficulties and risks that their parents faced in bringing them a better life. Madam Speaker, can Singapore continue on its path of success and prosperity? It depends on whether Singaporeans can look beyond their individual self-interest and have a consensus on the kind of Singapore we want for ourselves and our children. It also depends on whether we have enough Singaporeans who care enough to come into politics to serve selflessly, just like Mr. Lee and his team had done for Singapore, and whether Singaporeans will trust and support these individuals. I sincerely hope that all Singaporeans will build on the foundations of our pioneer leaders and continue to make Singapore a unique, extraordinary country for the next generation. This means upholding the values of meritocracy, multiracialism, and non-corruptibility, core values that Mr. Lee strongly believed in and which have now become our national ethos. Let us continue to do this and stay cohesive as one people. Then Mr. Lee would have toiled his life in vain for us. Madam Speaker, modern Singapore has lost its founding father, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. On behalf of my residents and my family, I convey my deepest condolence to Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong and his family as we grieve with them.
Mr. Thomas Chua.
Madam Speaker, it is with a very heavy heart that I represent the Chinese community and the Chinese Business Committee to mourn the passing of our founding Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew was an outstanding statesman and has contributed to the development of Singapore. In the early days, without any natural resources, everything depended on far-sighted and comprehensive policies, pragmatic and hard-working working class. Mr. Lee was a visionary, decisive, and good in seizing opportunities, integrating the concepts of East and West, and developed the economy. Not only did this allow Singapore enterprises to survive, also brought prosperity to Singaporeans. As a founding Prime Minister, during critical moments, he showed extraordinary leadership and courage. He made important decisions during critical points so that a small country like ours can have a foothold in Asia and created an economic miracle and widely respected in the international community. The prosperity of Singapore today cannot be delinked from Mr. Lee's persistence. Even when he was suffering a setback, he never gave up. He insisted on discipline and principles, honesty, integrity, and solve problems. And with his personality and leadership, he led Singapore to an endless path of development. Whether as a Prime Minister or as a Minister Mentor, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew insisted on the principle of multiracial and equality of different cultures. He was always interested in the development of the Chinese community and had very deep bonds with the Chinese business community and trust. He maintained excellent interaction with us. Mr. Lee insisted on bilingual education and emphasized the importance of maintaining mother tongue in the preservation of traditional values. This is the foundation for building a cohesive society. He encouraged the Chinese community to engage in self-renewal and always keep up with the times, to create close connections with the rest of the world so that Singapore is part of the world, and establish widely with numerous platforms for interaction with the international community. For many years, he was the main driver for closer relation between China and Singapore. We encourage our enterprises to go to China and the region to invest, to widen the space for our businesses. In order to seize the business opportunities in China, Mr. Lee established the Business China and integrated the strength from the various circles in politics, in business, and academia, and promoted the economic and cultural bidirectional cooperation between the two countries. Mr. Lee has left us the greatest legacy, which is he and his comrade in arms have established a system, a concept for the governance of the country. We remember him best by developing further the country that is established to continue his lifelong enterprise so that you reach greater heights. Although Mr. Lee is no more, yet his great contributions will always be remembered. His exemplary conduct will always be etched in the hearts of the people. Singapore, under the guidance of his spirit, will continue to develop. Mr. Lee, we will always remember you.
These are all Lee Kuan Yew's children. That was the nickname given in jest by Pak Nga when we visited him in Kota Tinggi, whenever his friends asked about us. At that time, Singapore had recently separated from Malaysia, and my uncle may be unconvinced that we will be protected in a country with a Chinese majority. Before he passed away, I had the opportunity to meet him. My uncle still teases us as Lee Kuan Yew's children to among his friends. However, this time, My uncle added that he was proud and full of admiration because we were able to become professionals and could compete in the Lion City with the other races. Similarly, that is how the global community views our achievements in Singapore, the attitude of doubt and concern, whereby some even looked down at us when we separated from Malaysia, had transformed into admiration and respect. In any country, whenever we flash our passports, we can feel that we are respected because we are Singaporeans. The blessings that we currently enjoy in our lives will not have been possible without the vision, the passion, and the determination of Mr. Lee. He built a developed nation that provides for the well-being of Singaporeans, even though our country do not have natural resources, and at that time, many Singaporeans were unemployed. In addition, racial conflicts flared up easily during that period. The whole nation was tense. Without a doubt, I can say, Mr. Lee established an administration that is transparent, eradicated corruption and crime. Singapore gained the confidence of international investors who came here to work and to do business. Nonetheless, for me, the most outstanding policy of Mr. Lee's came in the form of his unique social compact. After his failure in advocating a Malaysia for Malaysians, Mr. Lee was determined to create a Singapore for all citizens, regardless of race, language or religion. Everyone will have a space to cultivate their language, culture and religion. But at the same time, they were cajoled into accepting the government's policy of expanding the common space so that they can mingle in housing estates, schools and their workplaces. Ghetto areas have disappeared. Slowly but surely, a multiracial society living together peacefully is embedded in the DNA of Singaporeans. That is the view of Professor S. Jayakumar. Whereas DPNTO is thankful that Singapore prospers because all the leaders are mature and understood that harmony existed not because everybody got what they demanded, but harmony existed because everybody was willing to make sacrifices that may be painful at times so that we can all prosper together. As a result, places of worship like the mosques, churches and temples can exist side by side. And residents take turns to celebrate each other's festivals by having open houses for their friends. And friends became closer because they share the same interests and not because they speak the same language. It was Mr. Lee who supported the creation of the Mosque Building Fund, which helped build many mosques that are magnificent and thriving. However, no matter how much funds are collected, it will be useless if the foundations of harmony are weak and are not upheld by everyone. Because mosques that will be built will face protest, and those that have been built will be burned down. You can see the proof everywhere. A harmonious multiracial society is his most precious legacy that had helped our progress while protecting the minorities. If a harmonious society enables the minority Muslim community to carry on with their religion peacefully, Mr. Lee's system of meritocracy became the benchmark in education and employment for everyone. The Malay community should be proud because they have proved to the world that their excellence in education and employment did not happen because there was special treatment for the minorities. We were able to achieve our success and compete in the world-class educational systems, and funds were given to the Malays to succeed in education. We were successful in our careers due to our performance, and our self-esteem was safeguarded and is respected by the other communities. When I accompanied him to Malaysia, he spoke to a leader who spread lies about the Malay community in Singapore. He challenged that the Berita Harian paper is distributed there, and so that everyone can see how prosperous the Singapore Muslim community is in Singapore and how many of their children became engineers, became scientists and became doctors. I am so proud to stand beside him on that day. Clearly, he was proud of our achievements. Therefore, it comes to no surprise that global community and world leaders that I met, like Mr. Tony Blair and the Grand Mufti of Egypt, Mr. Shafqi Alam, expressed admiration toward the interracial harmony that is evident in Singapore. In fact, they were enthusiastic about the confidence among Muslims, who not only performed prayers diligently in the magnificent mosque that they built themselves, but they were also able to integrate easily as Singaporeans who are able to live successfully in a meritocracy system without any favoritism. This is the identity of Singapore Muslims that was built by him. My heart is heavy, not just because Singapore lost a leader. He has created a name for our small nation in the world. We, the child of Lee Kuan Yew, he is the father who was the architect of modern Singapore. Without him, we may not even have thought of Mendaki or the MBF. May the future generations honor Mr. Lee's contributions and build on his legacy. Beware about instigations that may separate us. Our obituary speech to him. Thank you, Mr. Lee, for leaving us a harmonious nation and an identity.
I wish to express my deepest condolences to the late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's family. I delivered this speech with great sorrow. When I was born in 1978, Mr. Lee was the Prime Minister. In fact, Mr. Lee was the Prime Minister from the time we got independence. His achievements are immeasurable. Many other colonies also gained independence at about the same time that Singapore had gained its independence. Those countries had larger populations, larger land mass, and more natural resources than Singapore. However, Singapore, unlike many of these countries under Mr. Lee's leadership, saw outstanding development. Now we are one of the wealthiest countries in the world. Our per capita income and GDP is larger than many other countries. The main reason for this is Mr. Lee's policies. Under Mr. Lee's rule, Singapore had a phenomenal growth. When he took over, the people were poor, had low levels of education, and the employment rate was high. Mr. Lee's government systematically improved people's lives. His government built large numbers of HDB flats to house the people. Those flats provided modern housing with water and electricity directly to the people coming from the kampongs. He made education affordable and almost free to all Singaporeans, and provided adequate schools for all. As a result, Singaporeans have joined the ranks of the best educated people in the world. More importantly, he created a dynamic environment for economic development. As a result, our people were well educated, had well-paying jobs. Mr. Lee's values were clear. He believed in honest, clean government. He firmly believed that everyone should be given equal opportunities. He was also firm in ensuring that no discrimination should be shown to anyone on account of differences of race, language, and religion. Indeed, this was very important for the minority races. Even though the Indians only form about 10% of the population, the Tamil language remains as one of the official languages. Mr. Lee, under his multiracial and multilingual policy, made a provision in the Constitution to include it as one of the official languages. Many world leaders have lauded Mr. Lee. They include people such as Margaret Thatcher, Tony Blair, George H.W. Bush, Bill Clinton, Helmut Schmidt, and Henry Kissinger. They praised him for his vision, tenacity, and his contribution to the rapid development of Singapore. It is indeed our fortune that Mr. Lee has been Singapore's leader. It is the duty of the present generation to take this work, his work, forward for the well-being of Singaporeans. The Singapore Tamil Writers Association commemorated Mr. Lee's 90th birthday with 90 Tamil poems. I wish to end my speech by quoting a few lines from one of the poems written by the chairman of association, Na Andiyappan, contained in the book A Tribute to the Great Man Lee Kuan Yew 90. You treated everybody equally, made Tamil as one of the four official languages, like a mother carrying her child, who would do such a thing? You condemned political violence, hated empty slogans. We celebrate you as an epic hero and rejoice. May you live long forever and ever. I'm sure he will live in all of our memories for many generations to come. Thank you.
MOS Simen.
Madam, in Mandarin, 我想
I wish to pay tribute to founding Prime Minister Mr. Lee Kuan Yew in two particular aspects: his contribution to women's advancement and to bilingualism. Mr. Lee has never described himself as a feminist, and yet his policies have made an immense difference to women. Mr. Lee had always valued education, ensuring that a good part of the national budget went towards education, even when our country's resources were meager. This has helped many women get educated and get jobs. We now see successful women in many fields. The Women's Charter has given women in Singapore the right to property and to be treated fairly. Women can walk on our street without fearing for our personal safety, enjoying a degree of freedom yet to be fully realized in many other societies. Mr. Lee's loving and lasting union with Mrs. Lee has set an excellent example for many families. But more importantly, Mr. Lee's basic attitude towards women was one of respect and set a tone for gender equality in society. He believed that traditional notion of male dominance and men refusing to marry their equals were outdated and must change with the times. Without Mr. Lee, the women of Singapore would not have enjoyed so many gains in so short a time. Bilingualism could well be Mr. Lee's boldest and most radical policy. It could also be his most controversial. Debates have taken place many times on this topic within and outside this House. We can expect such debates to continue into the future. Mr. Lee had realized in the early days of nation building that if different groups of Singaporeans were to continue using different languages, then our already limited shared space would be fragmented into separate little worlds. To unite all races and to expand a common space, Mr. Lee decided on English as our common language, as our working language. But to preserve our cultural ballast, Mr. Lee also maintained that each ethnic group must study its mother tongue. Mr. Lee also of the view that ethnic Chinese Singaporeans should speak less dialect and more Mandarin. This was a tall order for a young nation with a complex linguistic environment. It was already hard for someone to learn a language that he does not speak at home. But for someone to make a significant adjustment, even a complete change in his daily language use, was even harder. For those who saw language as a core part of their identity, it was downright painful. Yet, for a young nation with a complex linguistic environment which yearned for peace and unity, these changes were necessary. Mr. Lee's view was a rational one, better short-term pain than long-term agony. In every ethnic group, there were people who found it hard to adjust to the language policies and who still feel aggrieved to this day. But bilingualism undoubtedly widened our common space and laid the foundation for harmonious communication between all races. I have come across many Singaporeans of different ethnic groups of my age or younger who have told me that they appreciate the bilingual policy for giving them the tools to function effectively and comfortably in both Asian and Western settings. He really cares about the people of Singapore. Mr. Lee devoted much of his personal attention to bilingualism. He tracked our students' performance and constantly sought inputs from experts and researchers. In 1975, he spent 4 months helming the education ministry himself in order to ensure the policy got implemented. He created a Prime Minister's Book Prize, and in his later years, he started the Lee Kuan Yew Fund for Bilingualism to help young children to build a foundation for learning English and the mother tongue. His life's work in this area was encapsulated in his book, My Lifelong Challenges, Singapore's Bilingual Journey. Mr. Lee had stated that of all the combinations of English and mother tongue, English Mandarin was the most difficult combination. He walked the talk. He worked hard at learning Mandarin and never gave up on his lessons. This morning, Straits Times reported that one person paid respect to Mr. Lee this morning. He's 49 years old. He said, "I came from a Chinese school. I used to saw the bilingual policy made me suffer. But now I realize that now I can speak English. I can turn my company into an international one. The bilingual policy has changed my life." I think if Mr. Lee can hear this, he will be really pleased to hear that. Mr. Lee has brought us on a long journey towards excellence. We will soldier on even after he has left us.
Madam, Mr. Lee's language policy stands among the iconic legacies he has created for Singaporeans. It has left a deep impact on many, especially on educators and language professionals. This includes the men and women who are sitting in our interpreter booths, who ensure that what transpires in this house can be understood in the 4 official languages. He has led us on the road to bilingualism in pursuit of unity as one people, the preservation of our cultural ballast, and ease of interaction with the world at large. It is a long journey which we will continue long after he has left us. Thank you, Madam.
Ms. Chia Yong Yong. I speak in honor of a man whom I have never met. Yet I knew him from my earliest memories and for a long time as my prime minister. I never met him, never spoke with him, not even when he came to parliamentary sittings. I never met him, but he did much for me, for my family, for my country. He was an icon to me during my growing up years. Even as a child, I respected him greatly. But when I grew up, when I grew into a young adult, I became critical of some of his views and policies. Who was this man? I will never know. Some say that he was ruthless, but he said he was accountable for the lives of a few million people. He said it was about his life and about our lives. Some say he was ambitious for himself, but he assumed leadership over what, given the circumstances at that time, could have been a catastrophic failure, dooming his name in history forever. Some say he was arrogant. It would indeed be an unusual human being who is not. But on the other hand, I recall that he said this of the late Dr. Goh Keng Swee. Of all my cabinet colleagues, it was Goh Keng Swee who made the greatest difference to the outcome for Singapore. When he held a contrary view, he would challenge my decisions and make me re-examine the premises on which they were made. As a result, we reached better decisions for Singapore. He said he was not concerned or obsessed with opinion polls or popularity. Again, some say he was arrogant. But he said he thought a leader who was thus obsessed or concerned is a weak leader. It is a hard lesson for me. Some say he was ruthless, unforgiving, unrelenting. But children of his political foes had rights and opportunities like any other children. They were able to enter professions, able to become lawyers, doctors, public servants, because this is Singapore. Did he do well for Singapore? Look around us. We can say what we will, history shall be the judge. History will judge those who act, and history will judge those who only speak. As for me, I am convinced that if I were born in Singapore in an earlier era, or if I were born in a similar era but in another Asian country, I would not, being a girl with a disability, coming from a poor family with no connections, I would not have been able to go to school, enter a profession, and serve the community today. But I was born in Singapore in this era. Shortly after he had taken office, he said he had the lives of a few million people to account for. He said Singapore would survive. By any measure, Singapore has more than survived. Today, we are a reckoned player in the international scene. Today, our lives have improved, and Singaporeans have a strong foundation upon which to work hard and to make life better for ourselves and for our children. My parents taught me that when I take a drink of water, I must remember its source. Ying Shui, Xi Yuan, son of Singapore, father of Singapore. Pardon my inability to craft a tribute worthy of you. Words fail me, and today, all that I can say to you, my first Prime Minister, is what I never had the opportunity to tell you in person. Thank you, Mr. Lee. My father pays tribute to Mr. Lee thus. 建国之道，光耀成传.
His legacy of nation building will live on. The people will continue on the journey to build the country.
Sojourn with us. But his journey and the journey that he and our forefathers began has not ended. That journey will continue. This is our Singapore, and we will build it and we will protect it. So be it. Thank you.
Mr. Christopher D'Souza.
Mr. Lee Kuan Yew believed that no one race, whether in majority or not, should pin down another, but that all races should work together to bring about a united future. Therefore, Singaporeans of all races, including the Eurasians, salute you, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, for your beliefs which you toiled for at great personal expense, risking your life. Your toil helped to unleash our potential as a nation. The Singaporean Eurasian community is one of the smallest racial communities in Singapore. Yet, through Mr. Lee's bold vision that Singapore should strive towards multiracialism, the Singaporean Eurasians have found our way in our nation, taking opportunities presented to them on merit. Regardless of race, language, or religion, it is a conviction Mr. Lee held dear, and one which all Singaporeans are assured of. That conviction of Mr. Lee's was and continues to be of immense significance, of immense assurance to all races, especially the ethnic minorities, including the Eurasians. We have the space to practice our religious beliefs and our culture. We stand united, shoulder to shoulder, with all other races in Singapore. Mr. Lee's belief of a Malaysian Malaysia, which led to the belief of a Singaporean Singapore, not a Malay, Chinese, Indian, or Eurasian Singapore, has allowed each racial community, whether in majority or in minority or in small minority, to strive toward the ideal of multiracialism, thereby unleashing the potential of that other ideal, that of being one united people. For this, Singaporeans of all races are indebted to you, Mr. Lee. On a personal note, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew knew that I was the youngest MP in the 2006 batch. Although many do not know this, but he would encourage me whenever the opportunity arose and remind that what we do as MPs is worthwhile and lasting, even though it is tough, even though when it is tough, when we stick to our convictions. I had the opportunity to travel with Mr. Lee Kuan Yew and Mrs. Lee to Indonesia and to India on official visits there. In between the official meetings and the official calls, when it was just the Singapore delegation, he would ask over dinner or in the corridors of the hotel or in his hotel room, "Are you learning? What have you learnt?" He was a mentor and he encouraged. Thank you, Mr. Lee, for your personal encouragement. Thank you, sir, for laying down the foundations of the Singapore we have today. It is a deep privilege to pay a tribute, this tribute, to a great man. Thank you.
SMS Indrani Raja.
Madam Speaker, Mr. Lee first entered this Parliament, or its earlier iteration, the Legislative Assembly, in 1955 as a member of Tanjung Pagar, a seat he held for 60 years, an unsurpassed record. I once asked him why he chose Tanjung Pagar. He said it was because the people there were very poor, the conditions bad, and the place much in need of improvement. I did not fully appreciate what he meant until I read his memoirs. He described the Tanjung Pagar of 1955 as docklands, crowded with dock workers, trishaw riders, shopkeepers, and opium dens. Workers' quarters were wooden dwellings with no sewerage or drainage. He recalled scenes of filth and dilapidation among broken-down shop houses in or around Nasir Street, where Tanjung Pagar Plaza stands today. Drains clogged with rubbish stank with decaying food. He vowed to change this. He promised Singaporeans a better life. They believed him and voted him in. This allowed him to enter Parliament in 1955 and eventually go on to become our first Prime Minister. Tanjung Pagar and Singapore today are a far cry from what he described. Both have been completely transformed through his vision and his efforts. He kept his promise to the people of Singapore, and the bond was cemented. On sacrifices, let me say something about sacrifices. What we were called upon to do was to sacrifice the things that would have held us back. It was not people who were sacrificed, but the things which would have made us a lesser people, a lesser country than we are today. He called upon us to make sacrifices in accordance with some very basic principles: humanity, integrity, thrift, welfare of the people. The things we had to give up were laziness, corruption, division, hatred of other races. The things we had to give up were things like lack of security, lack of housing. We were called to make sacrifices so that we could put these things together. And we were also, the other kind of sacrifice we were asked to make was to set aside divisions and animosity in the interests of national unity. And who made the biggest sacrifice of all? In an interview, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew was once asked, at the end of the day, what he had achieved. And his response was, at the end of the day, what have I got? a successful Singapore. What have I given up? My life. The biggest sacrifice of all was made by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. And because of that, because he was a strong leader and led a strong party, everyone benefited. And Singapore is what it is today. And if you compare us with any other newly independent country, our people have more opportunities than Singapore. And let us see the response of Singaporeans. In the last week, we saw a tremendous outpouring of love for Mr. Lee. Thousands, young, old, rich, poor, from all races, religions, and all walks of life came, first to wish him well, and then to say goodbye. I have been at Tanjung Pagar CC every day the last 5 days. You have also seen the queues that have snaked around this parliament. You have to be there among the people to understand. People were in tears, and if you ask them, if you speak to them, all of them, to the last person, will tell you this one thing. They will say that the reason why they are there, either at the CC or standing in queue, is because this is the one thing, the last thing they can do to say thank you and to show respect. What is the essence of the man that inspires such an overwhelming reaction? Some might say it's his vision, his drive, his intellect. But these alone would not have been enough to generate this wellspring of emotion. The real secret of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's enduring bond with Singaporeans is that we all fundamentally understood that vision, the drive, and the intellect were all powered by one thing. He cared. He cared deeply for Singaporeans and Singapore. And all his actions were driven by a desire to make things better for them. Singapore was his life's work. And people know this. So, just as he was there for us on that amazing journey from third world to first, Singaporeans have been here for him in the last days of his life and now for his final journey. One well-wisher at Tanjung Pagar wrote, "Dear Mr. Lee, we cannot thank you enough for all that you've done for us and the land we call home, let alone the sacrifices you made behind the scenes that all of us will perhaps only learn of in the long future, or maybe even never. And in this simple card, I know that I will fail to express my heartfelt gratitude and emotions to you as well. I can't quite put into words the feelings I hold. Sometimes the lack of words says it all. History judges men by their legacies. And what is Mr. Lee's legacy? It is not in buildings or monuments. His is not a legacy of brick or stone. His is a legacy of life and breath, a place where you can belong, irrespective of the color of your skin, your religion, or your language, a place where you can be safe, a place of opportunity, and a place we call home. His legacy is a people united, a people with heart, a nation strong and free. This is who we are today because of this man, his vision and his leadership, and above all, his unquenchable, unconquerable spirit from which we took heart and which now defines us as a people and a nation, the spirit of Singapore. His journey has ended. He is now at rest. Rest in peace, Mr. Lee, and know that because of your legacy, Singapore and the Singapore spirit will live on. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Leader of the House.
Speaker, I want to thank you for presiding over this special session to pay tribute to the late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. I want to thank the various members and the members of this House for being here. Madam Speaker, I would like, on our behalf, to acknowledge the presence of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew and his family members, our Prime Minister, of course, Madam Ho Ching, his son's children, Mr. Lee Hsien Yang and Dr. Lee Wei Ling, his siblings and his extended family. Madam Speaker, we want to acknowledge the presence as well as to send our deepest condolences to the family of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. We would also like to tell you that of all the speeches that you've heard, that Mr. Lee Kuan Yew made an enormous contribution, a founding father of our nation. We want to thank you for sharing him with us, and we wish you again our deepest condolences.
As a mark of respect to the late Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, I propose that the House observes a 1 minute silence. Will members please rise? We have now come to the end of the proceedings for today. In accordance with the standing orders, Parliament now stands adjourned. Order, order.
What you have been watching is a special Parliament session in which tributes have been paid to Singapore's founding father and first Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew. 11 members of the Parliament spoke, along with the Speaker of Parliament, that's Madam Halima Yacob. They paid tribute speeches in different languages, English, Malay, Mandarin. And also present, we had Mr. Lee's family, as well as old guard leaders, the first generation politicians who, alongside Mr. Lee, took part in the anti-colonial struggle for